So I would like to introduce the new lecturer, Federico Cicarsenti. So you already heard basically a whole list of things that he's supposed to cover. So Federico, he really is the representative here of the mecca of this of these kind of calculations that is the physics department in the La Sapienza University in Rome. So Giorgio couldn't come, but having Federico is, well, how to say it?
Thanks.
I will better not say anything. So okay. I will let Federico talk about, you know, more deeply about replica symmetry breaking and interpretation in sparse graphs and all those things that you have promised.
Okay, thanks, Lenken, and let me also thank the other organizer and Leo especially for the great organization in this beautiful place of this nice, very nice school. So I'm very glad to be here. And indeed, my lecture has been advertised several times, so I will try to provide you a general overview of the statistical mechanics method that we have for solving models on sparse graphs. Okay, so I will mainly deal with sparse graph. And in order to do this, I will essentially start with a beta approximation, explain to you what is the beta approximation, and the replica symmetric cavity method, which is based on that. And I will try to explain you not only the theory, but also somehow the practice. So what happens when you run the algorithm, what you get, what you have to be careful about, and all that. Then I will pass, maybe in the second lecture, to the limits of the replica symmetric approach. So why it fails, and I will discuss all possible types of correlations that can arise in random graphs that leads to failure of the replica symmetric approximation. And then in the third lecture, I plan to solve a particularly simple model, which is called the random XOR SAT model that you already seen partially. Actually, you have seen in many different forms because it's equivalent to a P-spin model. And this will be a simple enough model that we can solve completely, and you can see really with your hands a practical realization of that picture of clustering that we always we always call into the game, but is not usually easy to visualize because it's a picture in a high dimensional space. In this case, we can really derive it explicitly. And so finally, in the fourth lecture, I will derive the most generic 1RSB equation on sparse graph and try to make the connection with eventually all the scenarios that we already presented and which has been already presented in other lectures, and so also some algorithmic consequences. So what do we expect for the behavior of algorithms in presence of all these very complex free energy or solution space structure. Okay, so this is the plan of my four lectures. And as a reference, I will essentially follow four chapters of a really beautiful books written by Marc Mézard and Andrea Montanari, which will be my main reference in the sense that everything is written there with the same notation and very nice. So why not use that book? So the book is this one. Mézard, Montanari, most probably it's called Information Physics and Computation. And the chapters that I will mainly deal during my lectures are chapters 14, partially 22, when there is a nice discussion of correlation decays, 18 and 19. So let's see if we manage to do this. And what is nice is that at the end of each chapter, there are references, but let me say, explained references. So it's not just a list, but it's really a very well short but short list but very useful list of references. So I insist to look at those chapters and also the references included at the end. Okay, so this so let me start from so our aim is essentially the following. Given a joint probability distribution P of X that we can write in this way, this is a normalization constant. We take the product over n variables of single variable function. This is a, like we call an evidence or a prior or a bias on the variable. And then there are interactions. We have m interactions, which may involve more than two variables. And I will discuss now the notation. So x are n variables, which may be discrete, continuous, as you wish, any variable type. Okay. I will use always the notation of doing summation, but if they are continuous, you have to think that summations are integrals. Okay. Now, since this function here, let me make an example so you recognize immediately what do they are. Usually, if you have a model with an external field, psi I will be exponential of beta hi xi, for example, if you have is in variables. So it's a local field term on a variable. And these are interaction terms, also called compatibility functions, if you are dealing with an inference problem. And this can be of any kind. So for example, you can have p-spin interactions that you write in this way. X index, say one index k, and then the indices depends on the interaction. Okay, so these are typical examples, and the main point is that the size of the interaction, we take it finite. Exactly. I will come to this. So in general, let me write it here. If I write xa, this is the set of xi such that I belongs to a. So every time I write a set as an index, it means the vector of all the component of all the variables belonging to that set.
And that's
2a
in the
no, sorry, da. Okay, I'm using this notation, which is the same one Guillaume used. But let me remind. So I will tell it in a while, but let me do it immediately. So let me give a graphical representation of this model. So I have variables and interaction. So I will use circles for variables, and I will use squares for interactions. So usually this will correspond to one interaction. DA is defined as the set of indices I such that an edge, so this factor graph is defined by a vertex set, which is the set of the vertices, so the circles, a set F of factors, the squares, and an edge set, the links. Okay, so once you define these three sets, you define perfectly this factor graph, vertices, factor, and edges. And so dA are the variables entering in interaction A, partial A, sorry. So the E such that IA belongs to the set of edges. In the same way, I will define partial I, the set of function nodes such that IA belongs to E. Okay? And since I'm interested in sparse models, the number of variables entering interaction is usually finite, doesn't diverge with n. Usually we will take it as a constant, k. I will be mainly dealing with two kinds of models. Pairwise models, okay, have k equal to variables interacting pairs, and non-pairwise models have k larger than 2, okay, and they have a different physics, like in the p-spin. P equal 2 is different from p equal larger than 2. And since they are sparse models, we want the number of interaction m to be alpha times n with alpha of order 1. Okay? So the number of interaction, the number of variables are proportional. In this way, every interaction, if you do a very simple computation, you realize that the mean value of the size, the degree of vertices times n is equal to the mean size of the factor vertices times m, and so this is a relation between the mean degree of vertices and mean degree of factor nodes, and since m is alpha times n, you always have that the ratio between the mean degree of vertices over the mean degree is k. Is alpha, sorry. Okay? So these are the models that we are interested in. In general, some of the things I will tell you, they hold only if these compatibility functions are strictly larger than zero. So you have to be careful when you want to deal, for example, with a constraint satisfaction problem, because a constraint satisfaction problem is a problem where this compatibility function is either zero or one, depending whether the configuration of these variables is allowed or not. Okay? So in the case of constraint satisfaction problems, this function usually takes values in 0, 1, because it says that whether a configuration is allowed or not allowed, okay? And you want to find a configuration that satisfies all the constraints, so all the compatibility function must be evaluated to 1, okay? So this limit you have to be a little bit careful, and so you have to intend this limit as a limit for beta going to infinity of a compatibility function psi I that you can write as exponential of minus beta some energy function. Okay, so if you give an energy function to, which is for example zero if the configuration is allowed, and one if it is not allowed, then you can write let me say the finite temperature model and take the zero temperature limit, and so everything is fine as long as the temperature is finite, and then you have to be careful in the way you take the limit. You don't have to forget anything. What are the typical questions that we want to answer? Okay, so we have this joint probability distribution, which is hard to sample because n is very large, obviously, and so the typical problems that we want to answer are problems like compute marginals. So for example, marginals or correlations, so which are marginals between more than one variable, okay? So for example, you want to compute the marginal on a given variable, so this is the sum over x minus xi. This is the symbol for subset subtraction, so all the variables minus xi of p of x. Okay? As you can see, doing this explicitly takes an exponential time. So we want to do this fast. Okay? And another problem is that of computing really the partition function, or better, the what we call the free entropy. Eventually, if there is some disorder, we want to average over the disorder. Okay? So you see, these two problems, if you do it in the straightforward way, are exponentially hard. And so we have to do something smarter. And this is why we introduce some approximation that allow us to compute this in a, say, linear time in the size of the system. And eventually, we have to understand how much this approximation is good or bad. So let's start with the beta approximation. And the beta approximation belongs to a class of mean field approximation. Okay? And as all mean field approximation, the idea of a mean field approximation is to ignore some correlations, only keep a subset of correlation that you think they are relevant. And thanks to this, we can factorize, at least locally, that joint probability distribution. Just to make you a simple example, the mean field approximation that I think everybody has seen is what we call naive mean field approximation, and it corresponds to approximate that complicated joint probability distribution with the product of all variables of functions. So essentially, you factorize over the vertices. And these, which are called beliefs, are your, say, your best guess about this local property. In this case, it's just the probability distribution of a single variable. Okay? And so what you do next in a mean field approximation, you say, okay, these beliefs are parameterized by some parameter, mean field parameters. Let me make an example. Easing models. In easing models, bi of xi is 1 plus mi times xi divided by 2. So you have just one parameter, because the variable is taking two values. So since they must be normalized, you have just 1 degree of freedom. And so by taking this expression, which depends only now on n parameter, while the original joint probability distribution was depending on 2 to the n minus 1 numbers, okay, you look for self-consistency solution, self-consistency equation that provides you the best guess for these beliefs, for these mean field parameters. And then with this approximated, factorized distribution, you compute whatever you want. And it's much easier because you have factorized the probability distribution. How can you compute your best mean field parameter? Essentially, you try to minimize what is called the Gibbs free energy. The Gibbs free energy, I don't know how many of you have seen, this is, let me say, is basic stacked mech, but let me remind you, is a functional. He did it. Okay, so I will be fast. So the Gibbs is a functional. So let me write this way. So the input, the argument is a probability distribution over n variables. Okay, and is defined this way. Let me use a physics notation. So this, like, well, let me put a minus beta here, minus beta is the average of the Hamiltonian of the variables over P minus the average of log P over P. So this is the energetic term and this is the entropic term. And what Gibbs proved, well, it's really one line of calculation, is that if you compute the minimum over all possible probability distribution, This function is minimized over the Gibbs-Boltzmann probability distribution, which is the right one, okay? So you minimize this, and you get that at the minimum, so the arg min of F Gibbs of P is equal to P Gibbs-Boltzmann, which is nothing but 1 over Z exponential of minus beta H of X. And the value at the minimum of this functional is exactly the free energy that you are looking for. Okay? So you compute F Gibbs on this minimizing distribution, and what you get, well, say the log of this, and you get the right free energy. So this is the free energy, you know, okay, the right free energy, okay, so log of Z entering here, okay. So in general, once you want to find the best beliefs that enters in a mean field approximation, you can take this and interpret it as a test function, okay? So this is the best I can do. I can factorize my joint probability distribution. I take this test function, I plug it here, and I minimize. And what you get when you take derivatives are, let's say, conditions on the mean field parameters. And for example, if you do it for easing, I let you as an exercise, but I will show you, well, I don't think I will time to do the computation, but if you take this expression and you compute the F Gibbs on that expression and you take derivatives, what you end up is an equation, for example, in the case of pairwise interaction that you have already seen, which is this one, okay? So this is a self-consistent equation between mean field parameter. And you can derive from this very general argument, okay? You decide how to approximate, at least locally, we'll discuss more this in the following, your complicated joint probability distribution. And once you have a test distribution, you plug it inside the Gibbs free energy, and you end up with some self-consistent equation for the mean field parameters. Okay, so this was naive mean field, and in order to go beyond naive mean field and do something better, you can indeed exploit the beta approximation, which is nothing but than a different factorization of the original probability distribution. So now you take as your mean field approximation for the joint probability distribution a product over vertices, so BIXI, times you want to take a product over all. So what are the variables which are more correlated? So the first correlation that you want to take into account is between variables entering in the same interaction. So, for example, the k variables sharing an interaction will be the more correlated. So, if you have to improve over this factorization, which is really too drastic, and consider that this is the usual mean field approximation, so when you do mean field approximation, you are doing something like this, the best you can do is to consider also a joint probability distribution of variables entering in the same interaction. So now I'm not only considering that variables have some bias, but there are also some correlation, direct correlation given by the interaction, okay? And in order to make, in order to allow, well, in order to make all this distribution well normalized, at least in the case where it is exact, which is on the trees, you have to add here the product over I belonging to dA of bi xi. Okay, you have to divide it by this this term. So if you want, you can rewrite it as the product over A of BA of X dA times the product over I of BI XI to the power 1 minus his degree. So the number of interaction it enters in. So 1 minus the degree of I. Okay? So you see, these are a new guess, better one, because you have including direct correlation between variables. Yes.
Is it possible to get the tab equivalence from this method?
Yes, I will do.
Oh, no,
I know. Not really.
No, you just have to add the entire reaction term.
But how do you modify the joint probability distribution?
No, but this is the naive.
No, here, yes, but you cannot do it from the beginning. What is your test function? So I don't know anyone who wrote a factorization of P of X that leads to TAP. No, obviously it appears the Onsager term, and I will show you how to obtain it from the beta approximation in the dense limit. So the beta approximation in the dense limit provides you the TAP solution. So TAP equations are the beta approximation to the dense limit. They are not the mean field approximation, because the mean field approximation, essentially, you don't have the Onsager reaction term. Okay? So TAP equation will be obtained from this approximation in the dense limit, not from that. Yes? No, for the moment, I haven't discussed about the... So I just said that I'm taking a sparse graph, but the sparse graph can perfectly be a two-dimensional regular lattice, which is sparse, because every variable interacts with four neighbors, or three-dimensional cubic lattice. All what I'm saying is perfectly fine, is also on a regular lattice. So these are, let me say, tools useful also if you do condensed matter physics in three dimensions. Between that and this, well, I'm adding more mean field parameters, because now I have these new functions that are described by some parameters, and I have to optimize over. Let me make an example. Let me write it explicitly for the easing case, so you will notice. So for the easing case, suppose I want to write this now, and easing pairwise, otherwise it becomes messy. Okay, pairwise means k equal 2. So bi of xi, you can write it as before. So essentially, once you give the magnetization, you fix the single variable marginal. But for now, ba, which in this case is pairwise, I can write ij. Is pairwise, so the interaction only involves two variables. This you can write it as somewhere in the notes, but 1 plus mi xi plus mj xj plus, let me call it cij plus mi mj xi xj, everything divided by 4. Why I use this form? Because now I haven't told you still, but one of the requirements in order to make this guess a reasonable guess is that these local beliefs are consistent. So if I take this belief and I sum over xj, I want to get back bi of xi. Otherwise, the beliefs are locally inconsistent, so the approximation is really bad. And in this form, indeed, if you take the sum over xj, this term cancels, because you sum over plus and minus 1, this term cancels, and there is a factor 2, because you are summing of a variable taking two values, and you recover exactly bi of xi. So For example, in this case, it's immediate to check one of the conditions I will impose, which is the fact that local beliefs are consistent. Okay? But you see that now you have more parameters. So here you have these M parameters, and here you have these M parameters. So while the mean field approximation is an approximation where you have to find N numbers in order to describe approximately the joint probability distribution of N variables, here you have to find self-consistently N plus M numbers in order to describe, hopefully better, the joint probability distribution. Okay? Yes? Sorry? Why is simpler? Because it's factorized. So locally, I will show you, you can compute everything. Essentially because if you impose a condition on the boundaries, then you can sum over all the variables. I will show you, this expression is exact on trees, and I will do the computation on trees. And I will show you how to derive an algorithm that fixes all these mean field parameters. Once you fix all the mean field parameters, you can say, if the mean field approximation is correct, locally, this is a good approximation to the true marginal. So, look at the notation. I use B for a belief, while I use P, it was written here, for the true marginal. So this is the true marginal. B is my belief, is maybe not the true one, and I hope is close enough to the good one in order to get the right physics or the right inference of values, okay? So, as I was saying, I have to derive this mean field parameter, so I have to infer bi and ba, and what I will do, first of all, I will impose some minimal requirements. Let me write them here. Well, first of all, these must be probability distributions, okay? So I want them to be between 0 between 0 and 1, okay? Let me avoid 0 in order to... then we want the marginalization condition, so... if I sum over all but one variable, I want to get back the belief on the single variable. So the sum over all variables in dA minus xi, or written dA minus I, these are all the variables in interaction A minus I of dA of xdA, this should be equal to bi of xi, okay? And obviously they should be also normalized, and it is enough that you impose that the smallest in the hierarchy are normalized, because the consistency imposes the normalization also on the higher order beliefs. And essentially the question is, how good is the approximation? So how close are these BIs to PI, which is the true marginal, and this BA to PA, which are the true marginals over a subset of variables. And this depends obviously on the graph topology. I will show you that on random graphs this approximation is very good, and so we can really infer the right essentially the marginals that we are looking for. But if you run this approximation on a finite dimensional lattice, we get something which is, well, depends on how good or bad, depending on whether you are close to a critical point or not. So now, how can we get the values for these beliefs? And the idea is to take this expression here, let me put it up. The idea is to take that expression for the Betti approximation and plug it into the Gibbs free energy, Gibbs functional, and take derivatives. Okay? This is not very easy, so let me just write something that gives you a flavor of how it looks like. So, for example, let me write this. So by this I mean all the beliefs. So B is the set of BI and BA. Okay? All the beliefs. If you take that expression and you plug into the Gibbs free energy, you get the following. You get a sum over all the function nodes. And for each function node, you have to compute this energy term. And since our joint probability distribution has psi I, the energy term is the log of psi I, because it goes up. So here you have the average over the variables belonging to the A interaction of BA, which is your belief of the joint probability distribution of these K variables, the log of psi A, okay, which is the energy. And you also have another term for the energy, which is the one given by psi I. So you also have the sum over I, sum over xi, bi xi log psi of xi. This is the energy term. And then you have the entropic term. And what is the entropy of that probability distribution? You see, it's factorized. So computing the entropy is very easy, because you have to compute the average of the log. But the log of the product is just the sum of the logs. And so this becomes, you take that expression, and you end up with a term which is minus the sum over function nodes, the sum over the variables in the function node of BA times log BA. You see, I'm taking the average of the log of BA. Obviously, it depends only on the variables in A, and so it's enough to consider one term in the probability distribution, which is exactly the joint probability distribution of variables entering A. And then you have the second one, which has a prefactor, so it's the sum over I. You have a prefactor which is 1 minus the degree of I. And here again, sum over xi of bi xi log bi xi. Okay, so this is the Bethe free energy that you want to is the free entropy. But you still need to maximize it, extremize it over BI and BA. So I will not write what you get when you take derivatives, but essentially the idea is that you can take derivatives, but you also want to impose these constraints, so these minimal requirements, these local constraints, because you want to find an extremum, so free energy, free entropy, always is an extremum. You want to find the extremum under this condition. So what you do, you write essentially a Lagrangian, which depends on the beliefs and on some Lagrange parameter, and this is nothing but the Bethe free energy, which depends on the beliefs, and then you add all the constraints you want to impose. So for each variable, you have a constraint imposing that the sum over xi of bi xi is equal to 1, and for each pair for each edge, and also for each value of xi, you want to impose that the marginalization of BA is equal to BI. for each value of xi. So this is the Lagrangian that you want to extremize, and so you have to take derivatives and you get some complicated expression. This is what you have to do when you want to solve the Bethe approximation in general. Then, usually, who studied the Bethe approximation, what saves you is that, for example, if you have an homogeneous model, all the magnetization and the correlation, you take it equal, and so this expression only depends on 1m, 1c, these are two numbers, and so it's much easier to minimize it. But in general, if you are on a generic model, you have to extremize this object. And so this just to tell you how complicated it is, and when we will come to the belief propagation algorithm which does it, you will appreciate which is a really very good algorithm. So once you take derivatives and all that, at the end, you arrive that the beliefs that extremize this expression can be written in this way. Bi of xi is proportional. Let me forget all the proportionality constant because these are probability distribution. They need to normalize. The local term psi I of xi, and then there is some exponential which depends on the Lagrange parameter. So this is the sum over all A belonging to the neighborhood of I, lambda I A of xi. And the same for the other one. So dA of x dA is proportional to the compatibility function times the exponential of minus the sum over I belonging to the A lambda IA xi. So, and the Lagrange multiplier must solve essentially lambda IA xi are fixed by normalization. So they will enter here to fix the normalization. So you can forget this as long as you normalize properly. Okay, so you forget this. The others, and as these are many, they satisfy the following equation, which is the equivalent of the self-consistency equation. So exponential minus 1 over di minus 1, sum over a belonging to di, lambda ia xi. This is, again, proportional, because proportionality doesn't count. The sum over x dA minus I, and you have to put all this expression here. Okay? So these are the equations that you should solve if you want to apply the Bethe approximation. Highly non-trivial, because these are equations in the number of these parameters. These are the size of edge times, this depends on the alphabet. So, for example, if you have easy variables, this is the right number. If you have variables taking q values, you also have one q minus one here. Okay, depends on the size of the alphabet. Okay, so this where you can arrive with the, let me say, standard Bethe approximation. And usually, these equations are simplified by taking the system to be homogeneous, so at the end you have much less parameter, and so you can find a solution. But in general, they look very complicated. So how can we solve this equation? So I will show you that there is one specific case where the Bethe approximation, so that factorization, is correct. It's on a three graphical model. So I call this a graphical model. Okay? If you take a three graphical model, that factorization is exact. And since it's exact, I will show you that we can derive an algorithm that actually compute the exact marginals. And so even in the case where there are loops, so you are not on a tree, which a tree is too easy, you can use that algorithm to solve this equation and actually find the most general solution to the Bethe approximation. Okay, so the first thing I have to show you is that the Bethe factorization, so that factorization above, is exact on trees, okay? So essentially what I'm claiming is that on a tree, P of X, the true joint probability distribution, can be written exactly as the product over A of PA of X dA times the product over I of PI XI to power 1 minus the degree of I. Okay? On a tree, this is exact. It's an equality. Okay? Where PA and PI are the true marginals. Okay? So if you integrate out all variables but XI, you get PI of XI. Okay? How can you prove this? Essentially, you can do by recursion. It's very simple. Take a tree, so okay, so this is a tree. First of all, prove by recursion. So the formula is exact for m equal 1. If you have just one interaction, this term is just the joint probability distribution of all the k variables. Okay, k is the, I always use k for, say, the size of the interaction. And in this case, variables are only degree 1, so they don't appear. So for m equal 1 is exact. Okay, now you want to prove that if it is exact for a tree, then it is true also for a larger tree. The blue tree, which is T prime. Okay? So if it is correct for T, it's correct also for T prime. But this is easy to show because essentially you can write the probability distribution on T prime as I should use X prime, because there are new variables, okay? As the probability distribution on the old tree times the probability distribution on what? Let me call A, the interaction I just added, okay? So you see the new variables interact with all the rest of the system only through this variable here, and I call this I, okay? And these are uniquely defined because you are attaching a new clause on a single variable. You cannot attach to two, because if you attach to two variables, then you make a loop. So by definition, when you grow a tree, you are attaching a new clause, this is called a clause, a new interaction to a single variable. And so it's uniquely defined the distribution of all the variables which are in A given xi. Okay. These variables only depend on xi, okay? So you can write the joint probability of everything like the probability of the whole tree times the probability of these two variables given xi, because they only depend through xi. And then you use the formula for conditional probabilities, and you get pt of x times pa of xi divided by PI of XI. This is just the formula for the conditional probability. And you see that this, if PT was of this form, also PT prime is of this form, because we added one interaction and the new interaction is here. We had the two vertices of degree one, and so they don't appear. And this vertex, which has some degree, now it just increases the degree, and so this exponent changes, decreases by one, and indeed there is pi in the denominator. So this is the proof. Okay. So if that expression holds exactly on trees, this means that the beta approximation is not approximation on trees. So that factorization that we are using, which is no more there, is exact on trees. So we can hope to learn something from solving a tree graphical model. And so let's do it. Okay, so for now I'm working on a tree. And what I want to do is, so how can I compute this pi and pa on a tree? Since this is a tree, the idea is simple. I can start integrating out variables from the leaf. Let's make all the interaction and so on. So what's the idea on a tree? You can integrate variables starting from the leaves, and suppose that you want to know the marginal of this over this variable I. You can start summing over all the other variables, and eventually you end up with pi of xi, which is exact. Okay, so if you write in formulas, we can introduce some cavity marginals by doing the following modification to the graph. Suppose that I take out so let me call this A and this I, and this is the interaction A. So I want to define this marginal cavity marginal, sorry, cavity marginals as follow. I will call nu hat I to A, and I use this notation that is already suggesting that then this will become messages running along the tree, but it is very informative in this way. So this is the marginal probability in a graphical model with a cavity in a cavity graph. So a cavity graph is a graph with a hole where I remove, so it's essentially without all the psi b, with b belonging to the neighbor of I minus a. So essentially what I'm doing in order to define this quantity, I remove all the interaction where I enters but A. So I'm removing this and this, okay? And I let me write it here, this nu hat I A of xi. So what is the information that this cavity marginal is providing to A? Is essentially the probability distribution of I when it's running the other way around. It's I to A indeed. Okay. It's I to A. So what is the information bringing by this cavity marginal is essentially the probability distribution of this variable when all the interaction but A are being removed. Okay, so in the presence of only interaction A. You can do a similar argument, but removing now A and keeping the others. So now I do the reverse. I keep this interaction and I remove A, okay, and I define a message running here. I call it new from I to A xi, and this time new from I to A xi is the marginal probability in a cavity graph without psi A. Okay? So I just removed this interaction. So these are the two. So you see why the name cavity. Essentially, I'm digging some holes, so I'm removing stuff from the graph in order to properly define these two cavity messages. Now, the question is, can I write the marginals I'm looking for via these cavity marginals? And secondly, can I write self-consistency equation for this cavity marginal? Essentially, I want to compute this cavity marginal starting from the leaves to any point in the graph. And the answer is yes. Let's do it not here because this is fixed. So for this brown message, I remove these two with the brown cross. For the red message, I remove the one with the red cross. So you see, in this case, I dig a big hole. Here, I dig a smaller hole. Okay? And in that graphical model, I'm computing, say, hopefully, the exact marginal. Exact, if you know, on a tree, approximative, and not on a tree. Okay, so let's write the, first of all, how can I write the true marginal in terms of the cavity marginals? This is not difficult. I will write immediately the expression I let you as an exercise to check that is reasonable. Actually, that is exact. So pi of xi, I always put proportionality constant. This is equal to psi of xi. Let me just give you a graphical product over A belonging to the neighbors of I, nu hat from A to I xi. Graphical representation of this formula is this. This I, and these are the nu hat coming from the neighbors. Okay? Is reasonable. So you receive from the neighbors all the information about what you should be. You add your local information, and this is the total probability distribution of you. Second case, you want to compute P A of the variables entering interaction A, and this is proportional to the compatibility function Psi of X dA times the product of all the information coming from the neighbors. So this is the product over all neighbors, all variables entering A, and this nu from I to A xi. Graphical representation of this equation is A. And also it's very reasonable in the sense that you have the joint probability distribution of all the messages incoming over the k variables, you add the interaction, and this is the joint probability distribution of the k variables. Okay, so now, so we know how to write the the self-consistency, the marginals. Now we have to understand whether we can write self-consistency equation for these messages, and the answer is, and the I still have to understand how to use the blackboards. And so in order to write the recursive, we just need to solve a branch of the tree. So for example, suppose that you want to you start from the leaves. So at the beginning, on a leaf, you will have something like this. This is one leaf, then here there is all the rest of the tree. When you sum over these two, you send messages on this interaction, and then from this interaction you want to send a message on the variable belonging to the rest of the tree. Okay? So essentially, here you want to obtain, let me call this A, I, so we want to obtain nu from I, nu hat, yes, from I to A, in terms of the messages arriving in I. And this is what you do when you really solve on a tree by summing over these variables, okay? So these messages are essentially are bringing information about the state of these two variables, and these two variables, when you remove A, are independent because we are on a tree. Okay, so these subtrees here, they are independent, and so essentially the messages arriving from here are telling you these messages are new from the neighbors. Let me call these neighbors J, belonging to DA minus I. So you have messages arriving from J to A about the state of variable XJ. You take the product over all J belonging to the variables in A minus A, in A minus I, and finally you have to add the interaction, and you want to sum over these two variables in order to get the marginal, the cavity margin on this variable. And so these variables you want to sum over X DA minus I. Okay, and this gives you something which is proportional to, okay, then you have to normalize the cavity marginal that we want to send from A to I. And so this is proportional to nu hat from I to, from A to I, xi. Where notice that xi, which is the argument here, is fixed. In this expression, you are summing over all xj, but not xi. Okay, so in this expression you have one variable which is fixed, is the argument, and the other variables that you sum over. Okay. And if you repeat the argument, if you repeat the argument now, going from, say, a variable that receives from its a variable I that has to send a message to A, so you can do the same here. It's much simpler because in that case you need to sum over part of the variables. Here you don't have to sum over anything, in the sense that you are asking what is the probability of this variable in absence of this clause, and it's just the product over all these probabilities, cavity marginals, and so in this case you have that the message going from, this is the message nu from I to A, and these are messages coming from, these are B neighbors of I minus A. And then, so these are nu hat B to I, okay? So we want to get this message in terms of this. Here you don't have to sum over variables, you are just asking about the probability distribution of I in absence of A, and this is the product over the probability distribution of I in the presence of only this, only this, only this. Okay, so in this case you have nu from I to A xi is proportional to the product you also have this function, because here you have one more term of the joint probability distribution, and then the product over B belonging to the neighbors of I minus A of nu hat from B to I xi. Okay, so you have one and the other one is there, and two equations which are self-consistency equation between the messages. Okay, so this has been derived on a tree. Okay, so essentially we are saying we can solve trees, but doesn't seem a big success. But now the question is, can we apply this equation, which actually these are the what is called belief propagation equation, but as long as I do it on a tree, they, let me say, it's overshooting called them belief propagation. It's belief propagation when you use them to infer the beliefs, which is much harder. On a tree, everybody knows how to do the computation. The question is, can we use this equation now to solve the much harder problem on a generic graph? And the answer is yes. Essentially, you have to use exactly the same equation. And actually, you realize that there is a strong connection between this Lagrange multiplier that minimizes this Lagrangian and the cavity marginals by, for example, looking at this expression and comparing to the expression for the exact belief, the exact marginal on a tree. You see that these new messages entering here, they play exactly the same role of the Lagrangian multiplier. You see, this expression here is psi I exponential of the sum, so the product of all the incoming information. So this suggests, and actually is what you can do, to try to solve this equation by making the connection between exponential of minus lambda ia xi, which enters here, and this is equal up to a normalization to nu from I to A xi. You see, this if you make this matching, you can try to use this equation to solve for these parameters. And actually, you can, in the sense, I will not do the computation, which is on, you find it on the book, but actually, this connection essentially is telling you that you can use an algorithm derived on a tree to solve a problem, a Lagrangian problem, on any graph. At least, you can prove that the equations are the same. So, this self-consistency equation can be rewritten in terms of these two equations, which are much easier both to derive and also to interpret, because here we derive it very easily, while in that case, typically when you do this minimization under constraints, it's usually difficult to give a physical meaning to a Lagrange multiplier, which is just a mathematical object. Okay, so here is the connection. And once you do this, you realize then, so, and for this reason, we can call this equation and that equation belief propagation equation, okay? So this equation and this equation here are what we call belief propagation, because while on a tree they are exact, then, and you compute marginals, true marginals, on a generic graph you are just propagating your best guess about local marginals, and eventually your best guess will be very close to the exact marginals or not, depending on the graph, on how strong are correlations. So the first question is, how do we solve this equation? Because still these equations are a large number of equations, because essentially for each edge of the graph you have two messages. So these are 2 times the cardinality of the edge set equation in the same number of variables. And in case your alphabet is, so in case your variable takes q values, you also have one q minus 1 here. So it's not a self-consistent equation in just one scalar. You have to solve this large number of equations, okay? But still, it's a linear number in n. So we reduce the problem of computing marginals and free entropy, which in principle is exponentially in n, in a linear problem in n, okay? How can we solve efficiently this equation? Because again, these are non-linear equations. When you take the sum there, depending on the interaction, these are non-linear, these are clearly non-linear equations. And even in the easy case where you can simplify and this marginal becomes one number, I will show you the explicit expression. These are nonlinear equations. So you still have to solve a large number of nonlinear equations in many variables. And so one possibility that usually works and is very, very effective is to solve this equation in an iterative way. Essentially, let me write it explicitly. So this will be our main method to solve belief propagation equation. As long as you are on a tree, you can solve them starting from the boundaries towards the center, and you have to compute each cavity marginal just once, and it's the right one immediately. But suppose that you are on a graph, generic graph with loops, you have no boundaries, so you don't know where to start. So where do I start in order to compute this equation? So what you can do is you can try to iterate and looking for a solution of this equation in the following way. Let me rewrite the two equations in a compact form. So this equation, I will write it as nu from I to A. Let me avoid writing every time the argument, is a function f I of all the incoming messages to I, where B belongs to, okay? And the other one, let me write it in a compact way as nu hat from A to I is a function f hat of A of all the incoming messages on A, so nu j A from j belonging to the A minus I, okay? So they are written in a more compact form. So a possible way is to solve them iteratively. What does it mean? Essentially, you take the right-hand side computed on the previous values, and you compute a new value, and you iterate this process. Hopefully, it will converge somewhere. So essentially, you can write nu at time t plus 1 is a function of all the nu hat at times t. Okay, I don't write all the indices. And then nu at times t is a function f hat of nu at times t. Is enough to increase the time just in one of the two equations. No. Okay? So you see, this can be run on any graph, even a regular lattice, or a graph with loops, or on a tree. Obviously, on a tree, you have a better way to solve everything. But in general, you can run this. And the question is, what happened to nu and nu hat, so all the messages when t grows? Hopefully, they converge to a fixed point. Okay, if they converge to a fixed point, we call nu star and nu hat star, even without the parentheses, the fixed point. Okay? Perfect. From the fixed point, then, we can compute the marginals, or better, the beliefs, because if you are on a graph, which is not a tree, it's not obvious that that is the exact result. And in order to solve this equation, there are some tricks. Maybe one of the most effective to avoid strange periodicity effects is to use damping. Damping means that you compute the new value, but you don't assign to nu the new value, but a weighted average between the old and the new value. Very simple and very effective, because if you take, for example, the weighted average with 0.5, 0.5, this means that the time will be somehow larger to go to convergence, but you avoid a lot of effects. Another trick is not to use always the same order to update the messages. So suppose that you are on a regular lattice. If you update all the messages always with the same order, you can again enter in some slow oscillations that don't allow you to reach the fixed point. So the best way to do this is update in a random order and with some damping. This usually works for any graph I've seen in my life. When the fixed point is attractive. If the fixed point is not attractive, you cannot converge. We'll discuss that in a while. Okay. And in this way we got the marginals, but we still have to get the free entropy. And the free entropy for the moment is written in an ugly way. Okay? So this means that we should take the fixed point marginals, the fixed point marginal, plug it here to get the beta free entropy. Okay? This looks a little bit not easy, and indeed it's very useful to do the following exercise, which is take the beliefs written as a function of the messages. Maybe they are there. Yes. Take these two expressions for the beliefs. So we are on a generic graph. So these are beliefs. If you take this and you plug it into that expression for the beta free entropy as a function of the beliefs, and you use some tricks, I will sketch you the tricks. If you use some tricks like, for example, let me put normalization constants here. So let's call Zi the normalization constant for Bi. Let's call Za the normalization constant for Ba. And there are also two normalization constants in this equation and in this equation, okay, that I will call Z from A to I and Z from I to A. So there are some useful tricks, which is, for example, Za, you can prove to be Zia, that now I define, times the normalization constant that enters this equation here. And also Zi, so the normalization constant here, can be written as Zia times Zi2a, which is the normalization constant entering here. Okay? And Zia is just the sum, sorry, I don't want to write it here, you don't see it. Zia is the sum over Xi of nu from I to A, nu hat from A to I. Okay? And finally, the last trick is that Bi can be written as nu Ia, nu hat Ai, divided by Zia, because it's normalized, so it must be normalized. If you use these tricks, you take this expression for Bi and Ba, and you plug it in that expression above, you end up to an expression for the beta free entropy that now I will write to you explicitly directly in terms of fixed point messages. So you don't have to go through the beliefs anymore. You just run BP, and when you converge, you take the fixed point messages and you compute the beta free entropy. And I will write here the beta free entropy in terms of fixed point messages. I will call it F of nu and nu hat. I don't put the star, but these are fixed point messages. You must evaluate this expression on the fixed point messages. Okay? You can write this as the sum over A of log of ZA plus sum over I of log of ZI minus sum over IA. So I never write where this index is below, but belongs, but it should be always intended like this. Log of ZIA. Actually, ZA, ZI, ZIA are already defined, but for simplicity, I will write it explicitly, because they are just the normalization, but ZA is equal to the sum over all the variables in interaction A, psi A, xDA, product over I belonging to dA, nu from I to A, xI. So it's just the normalization constant entering in the belief BA estimation. ZI is the sum over xI of psi I, xI, the product over A belonging to the neighbor of I, nu hat from A to I, xi. And ZIA is written here. So you see, the expression is much, much simpler and allows you to compute the beta free entropy very quickly once you converge to a fixed point of belief propagation. Okay, so this seems a good algorithm in the sense that on a tree is exact, because we compute really the good marginal. On any graph, it is well defined. Now the question is, from this BP fixed point, can we compute everything we are interested in? Certainly we can compute local quantities like the magnetization, yes, because it's the average of xi over bi. We can compute the energy. Let me write it so you see it. So we can compute local quantities. Try the big chalk. So for example, you can compute the mean value of xi, which is nothing but the sum over xi of xi times the beliefs. You can compute the energy term. The energy term is the average of say log ops IA DA, this is the energy term, and you can compute it because you just need to do the sum over all the variables entered in that term of the belief BA of XDA log of psi A XDA. Okay? And so from this you can estimate, for example, the total magnetization, the total energy, which is the sum of these local terms. Okay, fine. But if I want to compute something on a larger distance, which is useful because you heard a lot about long range correlation. So can I do it once I run BP, I reach the fixed point, so I have these fixed point messages by which I can compute the free entropy, the magnetization, the energy. But suppose that I want to compute the correlation between two distant points. A point here, and a point here. Here there are all the rest of the graph. Suppose you want to compute the correlation between these two guys. If you're on a tree, or on a locally tree-like graph, there will be, with high probability, a unique path connecting them. So it's easy. I just have to integrate out on a 1D chain. I know all the messages arriving from outside, which is bringing information about all the tree, which is on the boundaries, on the lateral part. So I will have all these messages arriving from outside. And I just need to integrate on a 1D chain. You can use whatever you want, okay? Say transfer matrix or just doing the computation explicitly. It takes a linear time, so it's not a big deal. But suppose that you are running your algorithm on something which is not tree-like. Because, as I say, for the moment, for today, we are not restricting to random graphs. So all this is perfectly valid also on a finite dimensional lattice. And you can use it to improve the understanding of a model that you are not able to simulate with Monte Carlo, for example. You can try to get some estimate from the infinite approximation. So suppose that you are on a regular lattice, something like this. A regular lattice has two-body interaction, so. And you want to compute the correlation between this guy and this guy, for example, okay? On a piece of a regular lattice. This is not a 1D chain. If I know all the messages arriving from the outside, okay, which acts like a boundary condition, even if this were exact, which is not the case on a regular lattice, you still have to integrate all the degrees of freedom, internal degrees of freedom, right? And this is not easy. So can we devise, and this is nasty because, okay, we did everything which is linear in time, linear in n, very fast, and now I want to compute the correlation at distance 4, and I need to sum over all these variables. No, this is not what I would like to have. I would like to have, again, a message passing algorithm which is fast and allow me to compute the correlation between these two guys. This can be done exploiting the linear response theorem. So essentially, the linear response theorem tells you that if you take a true Gibbs probability distribution, then computing, say, the connected correlation between two variables at any point in the graphical model, this is exactly like computing the response. There is no beta factor because I'm using I'm putting a term like this in the Hamiltonian. So you put a term like this in the Hamiltonian with a very small h, you take this derivative, and if the average is taken on the true probability distribution, so this average is taken on the true probability distribution, then you have a relation between a correlation and a response. Okay, so let's try to use this, and then we finish. So, should I prove this relation? Well, essentially, when you and also the you take the derivative, and you have one term where xj comes here, and you have xi xj, and then you take the derivative of the hj which enters here, and you get the disconnected one. Exercise. But it must be the right distribution, so the Gibbs-Postman distribution. The problem is that when you compute this guy and this guy in a mean field approximation, any, they are different. Okay? So in a mean field approximation, computing correlation and computing responses provides you two different answers. So in that case, I was trying to compute a correlation, so really doing the sum over all internal degrees of freedom, blah, blah, blah. What I want to convince you, maybe I will do it next lecture, is that computing this guy is better, because usually when you have a mean field approximation that breaks this relation, this one is less affected by the factorization than this one. So it's better to compute this guy. And moreover, this guy we can compute it by just modifying a little bit the period propagation algorithm in another message passing algorithm which is still linear. But since it's time, we discuss this algorithm for computing the linear response and so the correlation at large distance tomorrow. Okay, so thank you.